Ladies and gentlemen, your excellencies, distinguished participants, and co-chairs of the World Economic Forum on East Asia. To inaugurate the 21st edition of this meeting, please join me in welcoming Her Excellency Yingluck Shinawat, Prime Minister of the Kingdom of Thailand. And from Indonesia, we are honored to have with us the host of our very memorable 20th anniversary World Economic Forum on East Asia, His Excellency Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, President of the Republic of Indonesia. And from Vietnam, it is wonderful to once again warmly welcome the very gracious host of our 2010 East Asia meeting, His Excellency Nguyen Tan Dung, Prime Minister of the Socialist Republic of Vietnam. And from Laos, we are honored to welcome for the very first time His Excellency Thong Sing Thammavong, Prime Minister of the People's Democratic Republic of Laos. And please also join me in warmly welcoming His Royal Highness, Prince Al Khalifa, Prime Minister of Bahrain. And now, to commence the proceedings of the opening ceremony, I invite my Executive Chairman and the founder of the World Economic Forum, Professor Klaus Schwab, to chair the session.
Your Royal Highness, Mr. President, distinguished Prime Ministers, let me first, on behalf of all the participants, express my gratitude to you, Prime Minister, to you, to your government, and to the people of the Kingdom of Thailand for providing us with such a great stay here and to extending this very generous hospitality. We are here at a very special moment. The world economy is slowing down. There are quite some question marks about the future. But when you look at the ASEAN region, you feel that here you have a region which is full of dynamism, which has economic growth of over 5%, and which becomes more and more a crucial factor in the world economic and world political context. So I'm pleased to ask our host, the Prime Minister of Thailand, of the Kingdom of Thailand, Yingluck, to give us the welcoming address. Prime Minister.
Your Highness, Mr. President, Prime Minister, Excellency, ladies and gentlemen, Sawadee ka. It is an honor and a present for me to welcome all of you to the 21st of World Economic Forum on East Asia here in Bangkok. The government and the Thai people are proud of our countries. Was chosen to host this year's events organized by WEF. I hope that the change in scenery and weather from Davos to Bangkok would help promote friendly and fruitful discussion, and hope the weather is not hot, so hot for all of you. We are living in a time of both challenges and opportunities. From problems in the Eurozone to climate change on the one hand, to advance in technology, progress in democratic process, and emerging center of growth on the other. To address these challenges and to take advantage of opportunities, We must continue to promote regional cooperation and integration. And the key to this is connectivity. This is why the theme of this year's forum is so relevant. The future of East Asia will depend more on our connectivities. So let me share with you Thailand's thoughts on connectivities. In our view, there are three aspects to address. First is completing the physical connectivities network in our regions. Currently, we are well connected through the north-south, east-west, and southern economic corridors, all of which pass through Thailand. However, we need to support new initiatives like the Thawai Deep Seaport, which Thailand is currently working closely with Myanmar to develop. Once Thawai is linked to Bangkok and Lam Chabang Deep Seaport, the region will have a land bridge linking the Andaman Sea to the Gulf of Thailand. After 17 years of focusing on road building, another key project is building the train link in Mekong region. Some of the key projects including Singapore Kunming Railway Link, the new high-speed train link connecting northeastern Thailand to Laos and southern China. Second, it's reinforcing non-physical aspects of connectivities. In addition, to invest in infrastructure, it is also important to ensure that goods and people can move freely across borders. Therefore, laws and regulations need to be put in place. This is why we need to finalize the cross-border transport agreement among GMS countries. This will reduce time and cost at borders, transforming the transport corridor into the effective economic corridor. At the same time, we need to protect our regions from cross-border problems. In particular, we must ensure that connectivities will not be misused to pursue illegal cross-border activities. This includes transnational crimes and drug trafficking. Third, is developing connectivities beyond ASEAN and East Asia. Look ahead, we will need to enhance connectivities further between ASEAN and other countries in East Asia. This is growing trade and investment link between East Asia. The rest of the world, including South Asia, the Middle East, and America, it is only a matter of time before we need to develop connectivities beyond East Asia. In fact, some cooperation frameworks involving partners beyond East Asia are already exploring connectivities. So we need to ensure synergy among such a frameworks. Ladies and gentlemen, to be able to support regional connectivities and reinforce community building in ASEAN and East Asia, we need to make our foundation at home even stronger. After a few years of political instabilities and last year's flood, I am pleased to say that Thai people have once again shown that we can recover even quickly from any crisis. My government and Thai people are ready to move a new phase of development with investment in major infrastructure projects over the next 5 years. Specifically, we have planned to develop high-speed railway link to other major cities in Thailand, including Chiang Mai. Other projects, including expansion of Suvarnabhumi International Airport to accommodate 65 million travelers a year. We are also building mass transit lines in Bangkok metropolitan area. This project will not only benefit to Thai economy, but that Thai people, but more importantly, it will contribute to regional connectivity as well. Apart from infrastructure projects, there is also $11.4 billion investment in water management projects to ensure that Thailand remain a project production, remain a major production base. Priorities area include priority area include food and agriculture products, where we are in the top 5 net food exporter of the world. On this, I have launched Thai Kitchen to the World programs to promote Thai food worldwide. This will not only enhance our exporter, but we also have addressed the issue of food security. So we hope you can feel and enjoy the Thai food during your stay in Bangkok too. Thailand is also investing in promoting FDI in key areas such as automotive, hard disk drive, electronic products. There is also growing investment in services industry such as medical services, creative industry, telecommunications, clean energy, and financial services and insurance. With regard to human resource, we are determined to further develop women as a valuable asset for economic development through the programs, such as Women Development Fund. And for our education programs, we also implement like the one tablet PC projects. That's for all the child to have the learning of the new technology. I think the investment for the education is worthwhile for the future of Thailand. We'll help prepare our children to the world of technologies advance. In addition, our universal healthcare programs hopes to provide our human resource with greater protection. So you can see Thailand is not a key player to the region's connectivities, simply because of our strategic location. It is also because we are a strong production hub. This is a result of productive and skilled labor force, strong economic fundamental with pro-business policy through our own investment and with the support of FDI. We are creating value from a stronger and more diversified production base. In the year 2015, the ASEAN economic communities with a market of 600 million consumers will allow Thailand to serve more effectively as one of the production hubs to the global economy. We will continue to pursue policies to support this, as well as to strengthen our economic link to East Asia and also Asia Pacific through ASEAN Lead FTA and also APEC as well. But Thailand will not and cannot go it alone. We need to do this together. So we hope that to develop partnership within our region and beyond, both bilateral and multilateral, so that all of us in East Asia can enjoy future growth and prosperity. This is a goal that I believe we should do all the work towards. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to conclude to say that I am confident that with all of you present here in the forum, our discussion over the next few days will help us to find the creative ways to achieve a future of shared growth, prosperity, and greater connectivity in East Asia. May I wish the forum much success. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister Yingluck. The fact that there are so many participants and from so many countries, I think, is a demonstration of the trust into the future, of course, of ASEAN, but particularly also of Thailand, and a vote of confidence into the Thai people who have shown so much resilience after the flooding. I have now the honor to invite President Yuto Yono to address us. And Mr. President, you have a dual role in some way. You represent, of course, the strongest country in terms of economic indicators inside the ASEAN region. And you are also the country which is representing, if I may use this word, ASEAN in the G20. So how do you see the role, particularly also of Indonesia, particularly also in the context of interconnectivity? I invite you to address us. Please welcome President Yuto Yono.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to speak in Indonesian language. Sebelum saya menjawab pertanyaan Profesor Klaus Schwab, saya ingin menyampaikan pandangan saya tentang kerjasama di kawasan ini, pembangunan ekonomi di kawasan ASEAN,
percepatan and also the acceleration
ekonomi
of economies
that has been developed
in our region. And also, I wish to respond to the question conveyed by Professor Klaus Schwab. The theme of this year's World Economic Forum East Asia in Bangkok is very timely and very accurate,
shaping the region's future
through connectivity.
I wish to remind us all that
the future of our region, where we're headed to, it is not really a matter of it is not just about economic targets, but it is also achieving a region that is peaceful and stable. We want to establish a region that has a strong growing economy and also a region that possesses a strong harmony and a strong friendshipness and civilization. If we discuss the issue of regional connectivity, therefore, what we are developing here today must have an impact to three of those issues I mentioned. Three of them are important, and they cannot be separated. The understanding of region, no doubt,
kami akan bicara tentang
we will
ASEAN,
discuss the issue through ASEAN perspective, but also as we develop in our region, architecture, new architectures in our region that are not in contradiction but are complementary. For example, we all know ASEAN as an architecture. It is ASEAN 10 now, but now we are also aware of the East Asia Forum, or the East Asia Summit. That is, last year in Bali, we met 10 leaders of ASEAN, added by another 8 other leaders from China, Japan,
India,
Korea Selatan, Republic of Korea, Australia, New Zealand,
Russia,
and also the United States.
For
this reason, if we discuss the issue of regional connectivity,
the regional economy
today, no doubt we must see from those two perspectives in an integrated manner, ASEAN and also the East Asia Summit.
Inter-ASEAN,
we continue to strengthen connectivity that we have.
Kemudian,
we also possess a master plan, in ASEAN to accelerate and expand our development of connectivity.
We,
the 10 members of ASEAN, we combine our, integrate our potential, our resources, so that we can develop our connectivity in the next 5 to 10 years, so that we are truly able to raise our economy in our region. I only wish to give that example that, for example, has become an agenda and a priority for the economies of ASEAN in the context of industry,
kemudian jasa,
services,
pertanian, dan juga
agriculture,
kaitannya langsung
and also those relating to development of connectivity.
Pertama,
firstly,
kawasan ini akan
our region will continue to enhance our connectivity
di bidang transportasi
in the
dan
field of transportation and connectedness, in tourism,
food security,
energy, in energy,
perdagangan,
trade,
mutual investment,
telecommunications and information,
jasa perbankan,
banking services, that is most important today, education also, health, research and development, and also innovations, and also the media and the social media. Those are the agenda that is now being addressed by member countries of ASEAN so that we may try to develop, establish a stronger growth,
sustainable
growth, and a balanced growth in our region. At the same time, we ensure that our economies of each of our countries are also experiencing growth and development. Why do I take this example? What are the priorities of our ASEAN countries? Ladies and gentlemen, because the connectivity throughout ASEAN will be developed when there is strong intergovernmental cooperation. If we have a policy coordination within our countries, ASEAN has a strategy, we have a policy, and therefore we have a master plan. However, be that as it may, there must also still be synergy and synchronization of policies amongst those 10 ASEAN member states. And also at the same time for the business sector, by understanding more what is being offered by the ASEAN region, what is being developed in the countries of ASEAN. No doubt all of this will become a good consideration for the business community to invest in this region, to invest in the countries in ASEAN, to invest in Indonesia and other ASEAN countries. For ASEAN itself, actually, developing connectivity is not only to enhance economic growth, even though that is most important. However, we also wish to reduce the disparities of economies within ASEAN itself. And also at the same time, no doubt, we wish to enhance the prosperity of the people in ASEAN to reduce the poverty that is still present in some countries in ASEAN. In truth, if we discuss the issue of regional architecture, if we discuss the issue of regional economic connectivity, there are some already examples at the level of ASEAN, the Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand growth triangle. We have the Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia,
Sijoni,
economic cooperation. We have the Brunei, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, East Asia group, cooperation in economic, the Mekong level. There are also, it is there, but it is not sufficient. Now is the time, through a master plan, with a roadmap that we have established, we will enhance, we hope to wish to enhance in the next 5-10 years our strength and connectivity. If we use the logic of this approach, the strategy, and also the policies for regional connectivity, if we enhance it, if we bring this to a wider sense, East Asia, for example, no doubt the same efforts, the same intent will be explained with great business opportunities available to all business people in this great region. And we are also aware, we are also possess another architecture, ASEAN Plus One. We have ASEAN Plus Japan, ASEAN Plus China, ASEAN Plus Korea, ASEAN Plus India, also to have cooperation in a wider sense beyond ASEAN. But at the same time, there is also East Asia Summit, which I mentioned earlier. In the future, no doubt, we wish to develop
our economies, our connectivity,
once again, we hope to accelerate.
Kemudian,
and
Indonesia
also Indonesia itself,
at
this good opportunity for me to convey to you,
kami juga
we too are taking efforts for greater domestic connectivity. If you look at the geography, if you look at the region of ASEAN, Indonesia holds a big portion of geography that deserves to contribute significantly to of our economy into the regional economy. Therefore, we in Indonesia possess also a master plan to accelerate and to expand our economic growth in Indonesia, which in essence is nothing more but to enhance investment, infrastructure building, enhancing connectivity, in which my hopes, my earnest hopes will be able to contribute to establishing greater connectivity in ASEAN and also in East Asia.
Mengapa kami ingin secara
why we desire this so ambitiously to establish domestic connectivity. Because,
Alhamdulillah, ekonomi Indonesia, praise Allah, meskipun
in the Indonesian economy,
krisis,
even though the world economy is facing uncertainty, there's crisis, we in Indonesia are still facing 6.5% economic growth. We have human resources,
natural
we have natural resources,
energy,
and also we have energy resources. We also have a
juga
very
growing,
massive growing domestic
growing
market. We have a growing middle class. We have an increasing purchasing power built in our country. Those are the three issues that we have. It becomes a program. It becomes an ambition for Indonesia to enhance our economy, but also to enhance the connectivity in our country and in our region. If we conduct this in the best way possible, it will be for the benefit of all and will be contributing to the connectivity in ASEAN. Those are my views for the first part. For the second part, if I may very briefly explain to Professor Schwab,
Indonesia,
in the form of G20, no doubt, we also play a part in formulating strategies and policy making and even providing solutions to global economic problems. For example, the G20 summit, they desire to create a world that is with an economy with a strong, sustainable, and balanced economic growth. We too have the same vision. We too wish to establish that. The G20
and
the
system,
global financial system is stable. We too fight for that. The G20 wish to create a more balanced global economy. Therefore, there will be not excessive deficit trade or surplus trade. At least that is the expectation and the hopes of many countries in the G20. Indonesia too contribute to that endeavor. However, what is clear, we are a developing country, even though we don't represent ASEAN, but it is responsible for us to voice the aspirations of the developing world. The G20 must not forget to think about the interest of development that is more inclusive, including financial inclusion, including narrowing the gap of development, including the responsibility of the world to assist the poor country so that they too may escape from the shackles of poverty. That is my role in the G20. We continue that through also in other forums, and we promote also the interests of ASEAN in that region and other developing countries. Finally, if Indonesia's economy can contribute significantly to the strengthening of ASEAN's economy, which finally will create an ASEAN economy that is also an important pillar in the strengthening of the Asian economy. Therefore, in truth, Asia will also contribute to the global economy. As Indonesia, we are also playing our part in the G20 to contribute to the global economy. That's my view, Mr. Professor Balshab. So I thank you. I'm very grateful to be here today, Mr. Professor, Madam Prime Minister, my friends. It is my hope that as this forum concludes, our economy in our region will continue to grow very well. And we have many friends here from the business sector to invest in ASEAN for the sake of connectivity, for the development of our region. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much, President Yu Toyono. We wish you also a very good G20 meeting in the interest of the region and the world. I have now the pleasure to call upon Prime Minister Song from Vietnam. Prime Minister, you have been at the helm of a country which has become a kind of role model for transformation of its economy. Could you tell us, in your experience and in your perspectives, what is the role of interconnectivity in terms of having contributed and your expectations also for the success of your country, Prime Minister?
Thủ tướng Vương quốc Thái Lan, thưa ngài Lao Shop, Chủ tịch Diễn đàn Kinh tế Thế giới, thưa các vị lãnh đạo và quý vị đại biểu, tôi cảm ơn bà Thủ tướng Thái Lan và ông Chủ tịch Diễn đàn Kinh tế Thế giới đã mời tôi tham dự Hội nghị Diễn đàn Kinh tế Thế giới Đông Á 2012 với chủ đề Cơ hội và thách thức trong định hình tương lai khu vực Đông Á thông qua kết nối.
Prime Minister, could you just
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Madam Prime Minister to congratulate the Royal Government and the people of Thailand for their rapid recovery after the historic floods of 2011. Regional cooperation and connectivity is among the prevailing trends in East Asia, with the active participation of countries in the region, particularly ASEAN members. Along with the process of building ASEAN community, the association's members have been proactively coordinating with their partners within and outside East Asia to implement many programs, initiatives, and cooperation, diverse in levels and contents, such as GMS cooperation programs, ASEAN Plus One, ASEAN Plus Three frameworks, or the East Asia Summit, EAS, etc. These programs, initiatives, and mechanisms have helped promote dialogue, understanding, and policy coordination between and among the countries concerned, thus creating an enabling environment for and playing an important role in the growth of East Asia. Regional cooperation and connectivity are also a factor in making Asia's dynamism, helping it build its resilience against the outside shocks, particularly the 2008-2009 financial crisis and economic slowdown.
Những thành công đạt được đã tạo cho các nước Đông Á nhiều cơ hội và thuận lợi lớn để làm sâu sắc hơn nữa hợp tác và kết nối khu vực. Tuy nhiên, quá trình này cũng đang phải đối mặt với những thách thức và khó khăn khốc nhỏ.
Global economic restructuring is taking place vigorously amidst worsening production and business environment, increased inflation and public debt, hiking food and energy prices in the international market. This requires regional cooperation arrangements, including those in East Asia, to have appropriate adjustments. Apart from the objective hurdles, there are also certain inner difficulties in East Asia, as the lack of resources prevents many important cooperation programs and projects from duly implemented, while coordinating mechanisms are not efficient and integrated enough. Ladies and gentlemen, against the background of current developments to improve the efficiency of regional cooperation and connectivity, East Asian nations need to consolidate their political will and coordinate their actions. It is in this line that I wish to share with you the following solutions. First, it is necessary to enhance the integrity of cooperation, ensuring an active participation of all related parties in the committed areas. In economic connectivity, particularly the development of economic corridors, boundary projects, participating countries must ensure the integrity and harmony of the hard and soft infrastructure, regulations, procedures, and policies by designing proper coordination mechanisms for effective implementation. Second, East Asia needs to enhance its adaptability in response to changes in the outside environment to prevent the threats of economic crisis and recession and to achieve sustainable development. East Asian nations must first give priority to economic restructuring, renewing their growth models, strengthening monetary and financial cooperation, including the implementation of the Chiang Mai Initiative, multilateralization, taking the lead in the combat against protectionism, and promoting the early conclusion of the Doha Round. At the same time, regional cooperation mechanisms must also focus on response to emerging development challenges directly affecting East Asia, like widening development gap, climate change, their links to food security, water security, and maritime security and safety, etc. Ladies and gentlemen, following the heavy consequences and disasters in the region recently, I believe that East Asian nations need to work closely together at the policy level for national disaster management. We welcome the concrete recommendations made by the participants of the Sixth Asia Summit in Bali, Indonesia, in November 2011. In this process, East Asian nations might utilize the risk response network advocated by the World Economic Forum to have early risk and challenges detection and solutions advices.
đồng thời tăng cường hợp tác trong sử dụng và quản lý một cách hợp lý, bền vững nguồn nước Mekong vì lợi ích của dân cư và sự phát triển bền vững của các nước ven sông. Cần ưu tiên hơn nữa cho các hoạt động hợp tác cụ thể nhằm hỗ trợ các nước ứng phó với lũ lụt, thiên tai, xâm nhập mặn, bảo đảm an ninh lương thực và tìm ra giải pháp lâu dài cho việc sử dụng bền vững nguồn nước của dòng sông. Ưu tiên trước hết là nghiên cứu đánh giá một cách tổng thể, khách quan, khoa học và hệ thống về sử dụng nguồn nước, trong đó có tác động của việc xây dựng các đập thủy điện trên dòng sông Mekong. Including the construction of hydropower dams on the mainstream of the Mekong River. We share the views expressed by President of Indonesia.
Tôi muốn nêu hôm nay là vấn đề hòa bình, ổn định và an ninh, tự do hàng hải. Đây là một điều kiện tiên quyết cho kết nối và hợp tác phát triển.
Đang là mối quan tâm hàng đầu và lợi ích chung của cả khu vực. Việt Nam cho rằng các bên liên quan cần giải quyết tranh chấp ở Biển Đông thông qua các biện pháp hòa bình trên tinh thần hiểu biết và tôn trọng lẫn nhau, tuân thủ luật pháp quốc tế, đặc biệt là Công ước Luật Biển năm 1982, bảo đảm tôn trọng và thực hiện nghiêm túc đầy đủ DOC, thúc đẩy việc sớm xây dựng COC và tăng cường xây dựng lòng tin ở khu vực. Ba là tăng cường quy động và nâng cao hiệu quả sử dụng nguồn lực cho hợp tác kết nối khu vực. Nhiều nước trong khu vực đang quan tâm áp dụng mô hình hợp tác công tư PPP với sự tham gia của chính phủ, các nhà tài trợ và các doanh nghiệp. Hiện nay trong khuôn khổ hợp tác Mekong Nhật Bản, Việt Nam Nhật Bản đang phối hợp triển khai hiệu quả dự án xây dựng cảng nước sâu tại thành phố Hải Phòng và mô hình này.
Together in the implementation of Lạng Huyện, Deepwater Seaport in Hải Phòng City under this model within the Mekong Russian Japan Cooperation Framework. Fourth, the strengthening and consolidation of this Asian regional architecture should inherit and supplement existing cooperation arrangements and processes. It is because certain countries need to further bring into full play their proactive role from taking initiative and developing connectivity and to coordinate their partners to implement effectively ideas and initiative.
Việt Nam đã tích cực tham gia và đóng góp nhiều sáng kiến hướng tới xây dựng cộng đồng ASEAN.
Is a key priority
tại
hội nghị
cấp cao ASEAN lần thứ 17
tại Hà Nội. Việt Nam đã cùng với các nước thành viên ASEAN thông qua kế hoạch tổng thể về kết nối ASEAN với ba lĩnh vực
là kết nối hạ tầng, kết nối thể chế và kết nối con
người.
Việt Nam hiện là thành viên tích cực của nhiều khuôn khổ hợp tác kết nối kinh tế giữa các nước Đông Á, trong đó có các hiệp định thương mại tự do giữa ASEAN với các nước đối tác trong khu vực. Đông Á đang là thị trường thương mại quan trọng hàng đầu, chiếm 48% kim ngạch xuất khẩu của Việt Nam. Việt Nam cũng đã phối hợp với các nước trong khu vực thúc đẩy nhiều sáng kiến khuôn khổ hợp tác hướng tới mục tiêu củng cố an ninh hòa bình trong khu vực.
Thưa quý vị,
năm 2011 và 2012, dự kiến GDP của Việt Nam sẽ tăng trưởng khoảng 6%. Hiện nay, Việt Nam đang tập trung triển khai chiến lược phát triển kinh tế xã hội giai đoạn 2011-2020 với mục tiêu cơ bản trở thành nước công nghiệp theo hướng hiện đại, tập trung vào ba đột phá chiến lược là hoàn thiện thể chế kinh tế thị trường, phát triển nhanh nguồn nhân lực chất lượng cao và xây dựng hệ thống kết cấu hạ tầng đồng bộ. Trong quá trình triển khai các nhiệm vụ chiến lược của mình, Việt Nam chủ động tích cực hội nhập quốc tế, coi các quan hệ hợp tác và kết nối với các nước trong và ngoài khu vực là một nhân tố quan trọng tạo ra nguồn lực cho phát triển. Theo đó, Việt Nam sẽ tăng cường quan hệ hữu nghị, hợp tác với các nước láng giềng, xác định trách nhiệm cao trong xây dựng cộng đồng ASEAN, nâng cao hiệu quả
According to Vietnam, it strengthens its friendship and cooperation with neighboring countries, trying to display a high sense of responsibility in the building ASEAN community, improving efficiency of our participation in Asia cooperation frameworks and mechanisms. Vietnam will continue to improve its own investment environment, facilitating further inflows of international funds. And big foreign investors possessing high technologies and resource technologies to expand its export market. In this course, we look forward to having increased cooperation and support from Asian nations, international donors, and business community. Ladies and gentlemen, the World Economic Forum and FASIAS have been excellent.
And
Vietnam, we appreciate the effectiveness of the cooperation projects between the two sides, particularly the new vision for agriculture initiative, which is much important to, and we actively participate in such activities and dialogues, policy consultancy and initiatives that could help improve the forum's working. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. We are very pleased to have strong cooperation with you, not only through your presence here at the meeting, but through quite a number of projects which we undertake jointly. I have now the pleasure to call upon Prime Minister Son Singh from Laos to share with us his ideas about interconnectivity. Laos is one of the smaller countries, one of the poor countries, but nevertheless, I think you have shown very good signs of how you want to catch up with the rest of the ASEAN community. So, Prime Minister, we are eager to listen to you.
Panathan Yingluck Shinawat, Nayok Ratthamantri Heng Rajanajak Thai,
Prime Minister of Thailand.
Panathan Thanthi Mikiat,
Your Excellencies, the leaders, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the Royal Thai Government and the World Economic Forum for the warm welcome and for the excellent arrangement made for this 21st World Economic Forum. I am of the view that this forum is being conducted under the theme Shaping the Region's Future Through Connectivity is of particular importance, as it is being convened at a time when ASEAN is in process of implementing the Master Plan on Connectivities and aim at the narrowing of the development gaps within ASEAN and moving towards ASEAN community building by the year 2015. As for East Asia region as a whole, there has also been an effort to build a community in the near future. The political will, as reflected in various statements and declarations on East Asia cooperation since 1999, whether in the ASEAN plus China, Japan, Republic of Korea cooperation frameworks, as well as in the East Asia Summit process itself, has identified various proposals for enhancing connectivity between and among participating countries. Furthermore, the fourth Mekong Japan Summit held in April 2012 in Tokyo agreed on the Mekong connectivity as one of the three main pillars of cooperation between the Mekong countries and Japan. Therefore, I'm of the view that active participation of the Mekong countries and ASEAN member states in the implementation of priority projects on connectivity will definitely form a solid ground for future connectivity in East Asia in the future. Mr. Chairman, Excellencies, the Lao PDR attaches great importance to connectivity, and we are undertaking the implementation of a policy to transform itself from being a landlocked into a land-linked nation with its neighboring countries. In order to contribute to our national social economic development and poverty eradication. Towards this end, the Lao government has utilized all its domestic potentials combined with external support in view of building and improving many road linking north to south and east to west of the country, connecting with Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand, Myanmar, and China. The construction of the three Mekong bridges have been completed, and we are now in the process of building another bridge across the Mekong River, and we will officially inaugurate the construction of that project in the near future with Thailand. Another bridge across the Mekong River in the northern part of the country will also connect Myanmar and Laos. Furthermore, the Lao PDR has also started the construction of the railway link with its neighboring countries, namely with Thailand, and enhance cooperation within ASEAN, especially to realize the implementation of the Singapore Kunming Railway Link project. In the future, it is our hope that the Lao PDR can further connect itself with countries in the East Asia and India, both by roads and railways. The aforesaid achievements have made important contribution to the social and economic development of the country, and economic growth has reached above 7% annually, and poverty eradication has been reduced by 33.5% in 2005 to 26% in 2010. In the next 5 years, the Lao government aims to maintain a GDP growth rate of not less than 8% annually, and poverty would be reduced to less than 10% by 2015. In order to move the country towards ASEAN community and attaining the MDGs by 2015, and to lead the country out from least developed status by 2020. All these have nevertheless, the Lao government has continued to encounter daunting challenges, and there are many challenges that we need to overcome, and we do look forward to the continued support from international community. The goal set will be definitely achieved. Drawing from the experiences in the national development efforts during the past 30 years, especially after the end of the war, some of the lessons learned are as follows. First of all, there must be a strong political determination in the country's leadership in defining a vision and goals on social and economic development in accordance with the pace of its national development and within its own capacity and the need of people in order to bring about tangible benefits to our people. This has been reflected, taking into account the geographical location of the Lao PDR, not only to develop infrastructure for connecting with neighboring countries and transforming the countries from a landlocked to a landlink nation in the region. It is also imperative to develop infrastructure linkages within the country, especially in the remote and rural areas, in order to provide greater access to the rural people to wider markets, education and healthcare services, with poverty eradication remains a top priority. Secondly, the Lao PDR attaches great importance to economic development in parallel with social development and the protection of the environment. Third, political stability, social order, and national unity towards sustainable development are also key factors for our national development and ensure sustainable development. We also attach great importance to maintaining good neighborliness with neighboring countries, in particular in view of ensuring a shared security and prosperity. Last but not least, the Lao PDR highly appreciates the continued cooperation, assistance, and support from the international community, which has become an important driving force for attaining the MDGs and graduating from the least developed country status. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. We have just 5 minutes time, but I would like to ask each of the panelists a question, and if you could answer in one sentence, maybe in two or three. What is your dream of ASEAN 5 years from now on? Mr. President, would you like to start?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yang kita harapkan,
what we hope
ASEAN
is that ASEAN
yang memiliki
will possess
stabilitas
stability
di bidang
in the field of
politik dan keamanan.
Political security,
ASEAN
yang memiliki
pertumbuhan that possess ekonomi yang kuat,
economic growth that is strong and more integrated, and so that the development of ASEAN will be felt by the development of other countries of the members of ASEAN, and also ASEAN will be connected to the world, that we contribute to the improvement, the recovery of the global economy.
Prime Minister,
so if we talk about ASEAN, I think ASEAN has many benefits in different of the countries. I think altogether 10 countries altogether that contain about half of the number of population of the world. So we see the future of ASEAN that we will use the strength of each ASEAN to be the synchronized as one. As the thing that will be the world of the ASEAN or the territory to serve all the service and the growth in the future. That's my dream.
Yeah. Prime Minister Song, what is your dream?
Tôi thì rất tin tưởng rằng
well, I strongly believe that with the China efforts of the community of ASEAN nations, ASEAN will successfully build ASEAN community by 2050 with three pillars: economic, political security, economic, culture, social. And a successful ASEAN community by 2050 with these three pillars will represent an important contribution to the development of East Asia and of the world. Thank you.
Thank you. Prime Minister Son Sing.
My hope is that in the future, we shall do whatever we can to make our ASEAN to achieve our goal of narrowing development gaps in all aspects So ASEAN is one community with one unity and solidarity.
I think this session has really shown the reality of ASEAN. When we listen to the distinguished speakers, this commitment to ASEAN was very evident. And if I would add one final point as a kind of summary, so choosing as a theme for this meeting, interconnectivity, I think was right to the point, because everybody of you mentioned how essential the interconnectivity is as a precondition to achieve the political, social, and economic objectives. On behalf of all of you, I would like to thank our distinguished panelists, and I would like now to call upon my colleague, Børge Brende, Managing Director, to introduce our distinguished guests. We have here the representatives of ASEAN, but we are very fortunate that we have also Your Royal Highness as a foreign distinguished personality to share with us your ideas. And please, Børge Brende, if you would introduce His Highness.
Thank you very much, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. As we just heard from the distinguished panel, ASEAN region is fast growing and planning to establish an internal market by 2015. Another fast growing region is the Gulf. Through establishing the Gulf Cooperation Council, GCC, one has shown that collaboration foster growth. In this context, I'm very pleased to introduce His Royal Highness Prince Al Khalifa, Prime Minister of Bahrain, as our next speaker. Royal Highness.
صاحبة المعالي رئيسة وزراء مملكة تايلاند.
Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of the Kingdom of Thailand. رئيس جمهورية إندونيسيا. Your Excellency, the President of the Republic of Indonesia.
صاحب المعالي رئيس وزراء جمهورية فيتنام.
Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of the Republic of Vietnam.
رئيس وزراء جمهورية لاوس.
Your Excellency, the Prime Minister of the Republic of Laos.
السعادة.
Your Excellencies, Professor Klaus Schwab, distinguished participants. It is a great pleasure and honor for us to participate in this World Economic Forum and to express our profound thanks and appreciation to Her Excellency, the Prime Minister of the Kingdom of Thailand, for her kind invitation in this important forum, and with the participation of a distinguished group of economists, businessmen, and intellectuals. We would like to emphasize the great importance of the main theme of this forum, which is shaping the region's future through connectivity. We have followed with great interest your valuable interventions as they relate to the future vision of the ASEAN countries, in particular in the context of rapid and successive global changes at various levels, and which call for reinforcing mutual cooperation to realize positive integration of the region in the global economy and for the benefit of the ASEAN countries. There is no doubt that ASEAN has become a source of inspiration to many developing countries and one of the influential economic and commercial blocks in the world. And it is certain that this role of ASEAN and its impact will certainly increase with the arrival of the ASEAN community in 2015. We know that all countries and economic blocs have been exposed to the negative impacts of the global financial and economic crisis, which usually originate in industrialized countries, and their effects and complications are transmitted to developing countries with worst effect on rates of economic and social development. In fact, the global economy will occasionally encounter various forms of crisis that require us to address them in all seriousness and objectivity in order to mitigate potential negative impacts on our countries and to ensure that they have no effect on economic growth and efforts exerted to achieve development goals and increasing employment opportunities and improving social and health care. The Gulf Cooperation Council have made great strides in the level of economic and political cooperation during the last 30 years. We are now working to develop this cooperation so as to reach the stage of union in order to achieve greater economic and political cooperation for this group. The union will have a positive impact on the people of the region and opens new horizons for economic development, creating an economic bloc, estimated a great economic bloc. It is in view of this that there is greater need for continuing cooperation and coordination between countries and opening new opportunities for trade and removing obstacles to private investment to be able to limit the negative impact of the international financial crisis and stimulate economic and financial activity in the region. There are great possibilities and opportunities to realize the common vision adopted by the first joint ministerial meeting between GCC countries and ASEAN, which was held in the Kingdom of Bahrain in 2009, and to promote relations between the two sides so as to realize mutual benefits and interests for both regions, to enhance trade exchange, considering the great importance of both groups at the international level and on account of their development achievements and economic potential and the relations between the two groups. We wish to note in this context that the IMF statistics for the current year 2012 show that growth rates in ASEAN are 5% and 4% for the GCC countries in 2012. In addition, the GCC countries have the advantage in the field of abundant energy production, as their combined output amounts to nearly 20% of world production and 9.5% of the total world production of natural gas. And their sovereign wealth funds account for 50% of the total value of these funds worldwide. Furthermore, GCC countries provide ASEAN countries with one of the most important markets in the field of food imports and trade exchange in general. Finally, we would like once more to express our sincere thanks and appreciation to Her Excellency the Prime Minister of the Kingdom of Thailand for the invitation so kindly extended to us to participate in this important economic forum. We would like to take this opportunity to wish the government and people of the Kingdom of Thailand all progress and prosperity and a successful conclusion to the work of this forum. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Your Royal Highness. This concludes our official opening session. And again, I would like to express our gratitude to you, the panelists, for making this meeting a framework for our further discussions today and tomorrow. Thank you.